He was, I suppose, the first European thinker to enunciate altogether what it is that he meant by saying that man was social. The proposition that man was by nature social is an ancient truth or platitude, which certainly goes back to Aristotle, which is spoken by Aristotle, it's spoken by St. Thomas, it's to be found in the works of many Renaissance thinkers, in Hobbes, in Locke, and almost every thinker who has ever spoken about society. But Herder gave it a particularly rich and concrete content, which made the other statements about it seem somewhat thin and formula-like. For Herder, the notion of belonging consisted in the fact that the craving to belong to an association was just as basic a human desire as the desire for eating, drinking, procreation, or any other fundamental human need. He believed that every human being possessed this desire, and that to take it away from a man, in some sense, dehumanized him and deprived him. He passionately protested against the notion that society had to be conceived of as, in some sense, being formed by almost a species of mutual agreement between men originally isolated. Even as a heuristic device, this appeared to him to be a distortion of the facts. Men, as we find them, we find men initially and basically already in society. And the links which unite human beings are intrinsic to them. And the particular link which unites them, of course, for him, is not blood, not soil, but language. Let me read you some quotations from Herder about what he says about language, and you'll see the particular fashion in which he puts it, which I think is somewhat different than the way in which anyone else had ever put it. Has the nation anything more precious than the language of its fathers? In it dwell its entire world of tradition, history, religion, principles of existence, its whole heart and soul. In the works of the imagination and feeling, in the works which are expressed by a nation's language and words, the entire soul of a nation reveals itself most clearly. This is a doctrine which afterwards people like Sismondi and Michelet and Mazzini developed into an entire theory of nationalism. But in Herder, it's not a nationalistic theory yet. The theory is simply that if you wish to understand human beings, you must understand the movements of their soul. The movement of their soul can only be understood in terms of the particular symbolism which they use for the purpose of expressing what they have to say. For him, language and what is expressed are identical. It isn't the case that we have thoughts and feelings which are in some sense non-symbolic in character. When we think in symbols. The notion that thought is something, an independent entity, which looks for symbols to clothe it, in the sense which a hand might look for a glove, is to him a total falsehood. We think in symbols, and these symbols are not translatable. It is not possible, for example, there's a famous statement by Bruni, I think made at the beginning of the 15th century, who says, anything which is said in Greek can be equally well said in Latin. This to Herder appeared to be a total falsification of experience. Every sentiment had its natural mode of expression. Any attempt to translate one language into another meant the transposition of one form of human experience into another. Something inevitably was lost in the translation not merely of poetry, but of prose, provided this poetry or prose really was a genuine expression of a human personality and not simply a formal expression in the prearranged symbolism of some scientific or technical truth. The difficulty about understanding history or understanding society for him was the difficulty of understanding the use of symbols by persons who were brought up in a society different from our own. Let me read you a passage on this. How unspeakably difficult it is to convey the particular quality of an individual human being, and how impossible it is to say precisely what distinguishes an individual, his way of feeling and living. How different and how individual, anders und eigen, everything becomes once his eyes see it, once his soul grasps, his heart feels it. How much depth there is in the character of a single people, which no matter how often observed and gazed at with curiosity and wonder, nevertheless escapes the word which attempts to capture it, and even with the word to catch it, is seldom so recognizable as to be universally understood and felt. If this is so, what happens when one tries to master an entire ocean of peoples, an entire ocean of times, cultures, countries, with one glance, one sentiment, by means of one single word? Words pale shadow play. An entire living picture of ways of life or habits, of wants, of characteristics of land and sky, must be added or provided for in advance. One must start by feeling sympathy with a nation if one is to feel a single one of its inclinations or acts, or all of them together. In other words, for him, nations and individuals are in some sense analogous. both in some sense are what later became called organic entities, although he's very careful not to use this particular metaphor in any sense in which it could be said to be abused. The literal sense of national spirit or a nation as some kind of super-individual or supra-individual entity which in some way determines the behavior of its constituents, the sense of a nation which is there whether or not any given member of it exists or not, that metaphysical sense is absent from Herder. He remains rigidly and uncompromisingly empirical in that regard. But the heart of the doctrine is that in order to understand, you must understand the play of symbolism on the part of a voice speaking. And this is as true of cultures as it is of individuals. And as I tried to say last time, for Herder, every culture possesses its own shape, its own quality, its own tone, its own particular structure. And they're all pleasing to him. There is no favorite folk. There is no favorite nation. There is no hint of any particular nationalism in Herder. And above all, of course, he hates the state. He hates anything at all which appears to him to cramp individuality, to cramp the cultural expression of a group of human beings, anything which in any way is an obstacle to the creative process. He delights in trying to convey the individual quality of Greeks, Phoenicians, Persians, Georgians, Aztec Indians, East Indians, Danes, Jews, Portuguese, anyone who comes under his gaze. Whether he does it correctly or incorrectly, it doesn't matter very much. The amount of information at his disposal in the second third of the 18th century was not enormous, and therefore he makes at least as many mistakes about the actual nations which he describes as, for example, his predecessor Montesquieu. But unlike Montesquieu, he takes a peculiar delight in trying to express the individuality of each of these cultures without in particular even comparing them. Simply congratulates them for being what they are. And believes quite sincerely that in this great garden of flowers there is absolutely no need for conflict between any of them, that they can all grow together perfectly peacefully and each enrich the general human civilization of which they're members. The central doctrine is of course expressed when he says that every culture has its own Schwerpunkt, its own center of gravity, and every people has its own particular goal, its own particular form of happiness, and that these cannot be compared. And because he says this, certain conclusions follow, which were certainly unusual for his time and age, and certainly contradicted the entire ideal of the Enlightenment. Namely, that if it is really true that every culture seeks to realize itself in its own peculiar direction, and is entitled so to do, being what it is, then to ask whether, for example, there is, for any kind of general standards of value between them, for any kind of criterion in terms of which their excellences can be compared, becomes intrinsically and logically absurd. How can one ask whether, for example, Greek sculpture is or is not superior to, let us say, Indian sculpture? How can one ask whether Roman law is or is not superior to the law of some other nations? Each of them expresses the peculiar individuality of the particular culture to which it belongs, and they're all incommensurable. And he does flatly lay down the proposition that the happiness of one people cannot be compared with the happiness of another. So there is no way of comparing the excellence of one culture with the excellence of the other. Now, if you are going to take up the point of view, the general point of view of the French Enlightenment, particularly in the 18th century, whereby there is undoubtedly some kind of progress can be recorded, that men start in a condition of barbarism and gradually move through seas of superstition and darkness towards a gradual realization, so to speak, of the truth, of knowledge, of the organization of their life under sane and rational principles, the destruction of barbarism, the triumph of reason and good sense. If we believe that, then presumably there must be some kind of criterion in terms of these things can be measured. This is to Herder an errant heresy, and he denies it. And for that reason, you first get in him the notion of the incommensurability of the values of different cultures. And if these are incommensurable, then presumably there is no single condition of which you can say, this is the perfect human condition if only man could arrive at it. And this, of course, does flatly contradict the fundamental and central ideal of the Enlightenment, according to which, even if we cannot reach it, it must at any rate be in principle be possible to formulate a kind of existence in which all human virtues reach perfection and all these virtues harmonize with each other, simply on the simple principle that since to all questions there must be one true answer and one true answer only, and since no true proposition can be incompatible, or certainly cannot contradict, any other true proposition, the accumulation of situations described by all these true propositions must in fact constitute human perfection. This is a proposition which, if Herder is right, is a logical incoherence, cannot be true. And to this extent, what he says is not compatible or reconcilable with the central ideal of the Enlightenment. And although Herder believed in science, although he accepted him a great deal, certainly, of what French scientists had done in this sphere, although he regards with great benevolence and toleration all kinds of doctrines from all kinds of quarters, nevertheless, this particular difference remains, this gulf remains between them. And, of course, profoundly affected future notions of what a culture is. That is to say, he was the first person who was really responsible for the notion of the coexistence or the simultaneous existence of a number of forms of life, which each of which had to be judged in its own internal terms, which could not be compared, and which were, so to speak, which were misrepresented if judged by criteria drawn from some other culture, not drawn from within that culture itself. For that, I think Herder, at least for popularizing this idea, Herder is certainly ultimately responsible. Now, the center of this doctrine is, of course, you must be yourself. Don't live on others. Herder's perpetual doctrine is don't be a parasite even upon your own past. Because you are a German, do not worship the memory of Arminius. Do not try to be like Siegfried. Do not try and revive the marvelous heroism of the ancient Cheruscans, which a certain number of nationalistic Germans were already beginning to trumpet about in his own day. Arminius is dead. Do not emulate what Plato and Aristotle taught. Plato and Aristotle were Greeks. They are marvelous thinkers. What they say is well worth remembering and indeed celebrating, but they lived in the Mediterranean a great many years ago. You are Germans living in a northern climate. Aristotle is theirs, Leibniz is yours. Follow these particular doctrines, so to speak. Every nation must seek to realize those ideals which nature and mind, acting in combination, have produced for it. And therefore there is this perpetual sermon about be yourself. Do not lean upon others. This is in direct contradiction, for example, to his contemporary Winckelmann, who was also trying to escape from some kind of narrow German provincialism in the 1760s, and drew this famous ideal of Greek culture, simple, noble, sublime, so to speak, towards which he tried to draw the attention of his German contemporaries. For Herder, this was simply a piece of escapism of a completely unpractical, not only unpractical, but on the whole rather unworthy kind, something which could not possibly yield genuine fruit. We must be of our time. Soyons de notre temps, he said, and in this respect he in a sense imitated the Enlightenment itself. It is all very well for people to talk about Franks, to talk about Tacitus, to talk about the glories of the past. We must try and revive the glories of the present. You must do what you can, he said. Be as creative and as original and as sincere as you can, and let others judge whether you belong to your national tradition. Do not emulate the classics. If you yourselves create with sufficient degree of imagination and force, let others judge whether you are classical or not. That is Herder's essential sermon. And in that respect, curiously enough, he stands on the same side as Voltaire, rather surprisingly, against the people who constantly bring up the traditions of the past, in order to justify certain acts in the present. You will find in the 18th century, for example, that as part of the general political struggle of the times, thinkers like Montesquieu and Boulainvilliers, and even Mably to a certain extent, discussed the fact that, in Mably's case, the fact that the French were Gallo-Romans, in the case of Boulainvilliers and Montesquieu, the fact that they were conquering Franks, in order to prop up the claims of the French aristocracy against what they regarded as the usurping claims of the centralizing monarchy, they tried to revive the claims of the ancient Frankish conquerors and the particular privileges which these persons were granted when they conquered France as justification of certain powers and privileges on the part of the French nobility. Against these people, Voltaire, with considerable wit, produced those famous mocking lines. He says, to claim certain rights for the aristocracy simply because some ancient Franks did or did not conquer France, and that we must simply go back to these Franks, is rather as if you were to say to the sea, you were originally at Fréjus, you were originally at Ferrara, you were originally at Ravenna, You left these places. Go back there immediately. This sentiment is precisely what Herder employs in adjuring his fellow Germans in saying, never mind about the privileges of the past, never mind about the dark Teuton woods, never mind about the fact that liberties are supposed to have come out of these dark woods and fructified decadent Europe during the ages of dark barbarian rebellions. This is all over. Today, we must revive the German genius by simply not imitating, in a pale manner, ideals not our own. It is better to be a German, an ordinary, normal Saxon or Prussian or Westphalian, than a fourth-rate Frenchman, which is what most Germans are at the moment seeking to be. And that was the general content of what might be called any degree of nationalism or patriotism which Herder's sermons contain. If you say, where does this come from in Herder, so to speak, this particular attitude, so to speak, the notion that cultures are different from each other, that the ideals are different, that assimilation is always a sign of disease, that nostalgia, he says, is the worthiest of all pains, because people wish to be at home. It's very difficult to trace the roots of this. Perhaps it goes back to Damasius and earlier German thinkers in the 18th century, but mainly it has to be recognized as being original in Herder himself. Herder's ideal for a human being is what Hegel afterwards defined liberty as being, bei sich selbst sein, to be at home. In order to be at home, you must live within a community which in some sense takes you for granted, which you take for granted, with which you can communicate. To be lonely is not to be to say things and not to be understood. That's the essence of solitude. It isn't to live by oneself. To live by oneself is quite easy and very desirable, perhaps, in the case of contemplative thinkers. But to speak and not to be understood, that is a condition of gloom and alienation and must at all costs be avoided. How is it to be avoided? Why? By, of course, living among people with whom you have some kind of natural kinship or affinity. The heart of Herder's doctrine is roughly this, that as a result of the working of natural forces, perhaps nature, climate, but also as a result of working of certain spiritual forces, which he enlarges upon, there are human communities, some large, some small. That there are certain impalpable connections between members living in the same community which unite them in a manner closer than that with which you are united with human beings living in other communities. That, for example, if you are a German, then the way in which you pass legislation, the way in which you write poetry, your handwriting, your manner of getting up and sitting down, your manner of eating, your manner of brushing your hair, your manner of writing hymns, your manner of dancing, your manner of ruling yourself, your large and your small acts, your small personal idiosyncrasies, as well as your large collective policies and attitudes, all these things have something in common, have a certain internal, if you like, resemblance, or at any rate kinship, affinity, which they do not possess to similar acts on the part of the Portuguese. Of course, Portuguese legislation resembles German legislation. And Portuguese, the way in which the Portuguese brush their hair may resemble the way in which the Germans brush their hair. But there is something about the brushing of German hair, and the way in which the Germans pass their laws, and the particular form and rhythm of German ballads, or hymns, or dances, which is directly detectable as being German by a German, so that as soon as he comes into contact with it, he might be said to feel at home, he might be said to have a certain feeling of kinship. The sort of sense in which Pushkin, for example, talking about the Russians later, said, there is Russia here, here it smells of the Russian spirit, in the way in which the Frenchman talked about La France éternelle, and so on. The way in which Rupert Brooke talked about a corner of England in some faraway forgotten foreign field and so on. That sort of sense of some kind of gestalt quality which immediately conveys to you some sort of flow of, if you like, of feeling embodied in a language, embodied in an accent, embodied in a particular peculiar way of speaking and thinking and feeling, that, so to speak, is what, in fact, human beings cannot live without in some way being diminished thereby. This, I think, is what Herder put on the map. In other words, this is the analysis of what it means to belong. And although, no doubt, this was a feeling which is felt by most human beings in most places, most times in the history of the world, it was Herder who first defined it, and or if not defined it, at any rate gave an analysis of it and a description of it, which stuck. And this, I think, is perhaps his major service so far as the actual, so to speak, contribution to human self-knowledge is concerned. Now, as I say, if you say, where does this come from? Well, of course, the resistance to foreign influence in Germany was is an older thing that Herder Tomasius already began to lecture in German. Leibniz contains texts in which he begs, wishes the German language to flourish and be strong, and not always for German thinkers not always to be forced to use Latin, as he himself, of course, only too frequently did, and so forth. This is there. You will find a certain amount of invocation to the German language as early as the 16th century, and even before that. But it was really, I think, an original impulse on Herder's own part, which put these things on the map.